Okay, so we can start. Dobar dan, dobro jutro, profesore Močnik. Drago nam je da ste pristali održati keynote predavanje, dakle na petom međunarodnom znanstvenom skupu Socijalizam na klupi s temom antifašizam. Naravno, prema dogovoru, dakle, predavanje i moje predstavljanje vas, dakle, bit će na engleskom iz pragmatičnih razloga, tako da nas kolege, dakle, iz cijeloga svijeta mogu razumjeti. Kako imamo 45 minuta, ja predlažem da onda odmah krenemo, ja ću vas predstaviti, onda vi odmah možete krenuti sa svojim predavanjem. So, to change the code, it is a great question if Professor Močnik needs a presentation. Everybody knows who he is, everybody knows what he does, but let me just present him in a few words. So, Rastko Močnik is a sociologist, literary theorist, translator, and political activist who teaches at the University of Ljubljana, or who taught at University of Ljubljana and Faculty of Media and Communication, Singidunum University, Belgrade. But also he is one of the most well-known theorists coming from this part of Europe. He has been an active and present voice for several decades now. This is why it gives us a great pleasure to listen to his keynote speech today. Among his recent and not so recent books, we can find Teoria sa ideologijom, Spisi o suvremenom kapitalizmu, that was translated in Croatian, also from Slovenian, o pisanju zgodovine, Spisi iz humanistike, tri teorije, institucija, nacija, država, koliko fašizma, rasprave o postkomunizmu, teorije za naše vreme, Claude Lévi-Strauss, Marcel Mauss, Emil Durkheim, and others. Professor Močnik has written extensively for numerous international journals, and he has also contributed to many edited anthologies, of course, as you can imagine. Professor Močnik will address today with the keynote lecture, Antifascism Today. So said this, Rastko, I welcome you once again, and please, the Zoom is all yours.
Thank you, Andreas. Thank you also for your presentation. I hope it hasn't raised expectations too high, for my presentation will be modest, an introduction to the debate, that's going on, ongoing debate. Thank you to the organizers for having invited me, and good morning to all the colleagues that are sharing this Zoom. There are too many colleagues that I would like to greet personally, so I only extend a collective greeting. So I've prepared a PowerPoint presentation to facilitate the exchange of our views, and I'll now set it on. Full screen. Yes. Now this is the plan of the presentation. I will present a hypothesis about three kinds of the crisis management, of the management of the present crisis of world capitalism, post-fascism in the center, neo-fascism on the semi-periphery, illiberal democracy on the semi-periphery. Illiberal democracy will be the main topic of our talk, since post-fascism in the center is contained by present liberal politics, and neo-fascism on the semi-periphery, which means radical right, is for the moment, my perception, marginal. My argumentation will consist of two parts. I will present the paradox of protest against semi-peripheral liberal democracy. I choose the case of Slovenia because it's closest to me, and also because it's very telling. It shows very explicitly the contradictions of the present anti-fascist commitment. And then my second argumentation will be about the complex structuring in Europe, specifically of European Union, which means that there is a center and periphery, but both the center and the periphery are hierarchically structured in multiple ways. That's my point of my talk. Anti-fascism is not enough. It is necessary to abolish the conditions of the emergence of the crisis management by neo-fascism and illiberal democracy, which means we have to eliminate the conditions of recurring crisis. Basically, that means to exit capitalism. We first need to distinguish historical fascisms, neo-fascism on the periphery and semi-periphery. For example, in post-socialism, for the time being, this neo-fascism is relatively marginal. Illiberal democracy in post-socialism, which seems to be gaining importance, I will show why this is so, and post-fascism in the center, for example, in the center of European Union, which for the moment is contained by liberal strategies of policy making. Now, here are the parties that could be considered radical. Some of them claim to be left, most of them are explicitly right wing parties. Now those in blue shadow are those that are the most important for my talk and are faring very well. They are government parties like Serbian Progressive Party or self-determination movement in Kosovo that claims to be left-wing political party, Fidesz, long-time governing party in Hungary, the political formation that has introduced the novelty of illiberal democracy, Law and Justice in Poland, also government party, an opposition party in Macedonia, VMRO DPMNE, Macedonian nationalists, radical nationalists. And then a newcomer, Slovene Democratic Party, the government party, the leading party of the present coalition, and GERB, Bulgarian party that is presently in opposition, but is close to the power and was in leading the governmental coalition in the past. So we skip the other movements and parties, but we see that they are all faring quite well. They are, even if they are in opposition, they are second by rank or third. The exception is National Rally, Rassemblement National in France, which is losing its ground and is presently in opposition with a very low rank. Now, the general frame of our presentation will be class struggles in the center of the capitalist system and in the post-socialist semi-periphery. Now, for the center of capitalist system, we take the scheme from a book by French economists Gérard Dumesnil and Dominique Lévy, Managerial Capitalism. The hypothesis is that the capitalist classes actually lost the social domination during the crisis of the 30s of the 20th century, and that managerial classes gained control of the social processes more or less during the 30s of the 20th century. And of course, there are popular classes, the classes that produce the riches of our societies. Now, this disposition makes room for two types of political compromises, compromise on the right and compromise on the left. This is a typical schematization for the center of the capitalist system, or the past center, which means the Euro-Atlantic center of world capitalism. Now, for post-socialist semi-periphery, I take the clue from historical conditions that were set in socialist Yugoslavia. My idea is that there were three main political formations, or politico-economical ideological class formations in socialist Yugoslavia, and probably also in other historical socialisms. On the national level, political bureaucracy had both the capacity to set the means of production in motion and the power to appropriate and dispose of the product. Now, when we speak about national economy in Yugoslavia, we should distinguish between federal national economy, which was strong during the 50s and the beginning of the 60s of the 20th century, and federal units, the republican national economies, which gained strength from the 65 economic reform on, and which finally destroyed Socialist Federation. Now, on the level of the enterprise, there was a classical, to my sense, classical capitalist antagonistic contradiction between workers' collectives and economic bureaucracy or high management. Now, the contradiction which was antagonistic between workers and political bureaucracy was specifically socialist, because political bureaucracy is a specific product of socialist revolutions, in this sense that in all other modern states, political bureaucracy is under the control of the dominating classes, be they capitalist classes or managerial classes. Now, socialist political bureaucracy is under no control of a dominating class, because the bourgeoisie has been destroyed, was destroyed, had been destroyed by the revolution, and this bureaucracy prevents workers to take control of society, to establish themselves as the dominating class. And there is a conflict between political bureaucracy and economic bureaucracy or high management, which was quite evident and explicit in socialist Yugoslavia. The economic bureaucracy was called technocracy or techno-liberals at that time, but this antagonism, this contradiction was non-antagonistic, which was proven by later developments. Now, let's speak about historical fascisms, because we have to distinguish historical fascisms from the present political formations and political practices. We should not get blinded. Excuse me. We should not get blinded by comparisons between historical fascisms and present trends and practices, because the historical situation is radically different. But on a very abstract level, there are similarities. Historical fascisms, according to most theories, starting with Trotsky, were a conjunction of two heterogeneous processes: a class recomposition of national bourgeoisie from a historical position of structural weakness. So national bourgeoisies had to readapt, to reaccommodate themselves to the crisis of world capitalism, and also to their internal and international weakness, like in Italy or in Germany. And on the other side, the fascism presupposes class decomposition of the working masses with both economic pressure and state violence, a destruction of alliances on the left. So a new compromise on the right is formed Under the condition of destruction of the working masses, of their political and social organization. And this new compromise between capitalist class, managerial class, and political bureaucracy can be reached in several ways. In the center of the system in the United States, it was New Deal. It was a welfare state policy designed to defend the existence of capitalist system. It can be fascism on the periphery, like in Italy, or it can be Nazism in semi-periphery, like Germany, or clero-fascism, which means fascism with the support of Catholic Church, like in Spain, in Franco's Spain, or in independent state of Croatia, Nezavisna država Hrvatska, during World War II. So, illiberal democracy and post-socialism, which is the main focus of our discussion today, is also the result of a conjunction of two heterogeneous processes, the rearticulation of the former ruling coalitions, political bureaucracy, economic bureaucracy, in the view of composing themselves into national bourgeoisies. So we have the two strong groupations of socialism, political bureaucracy and economic bureaucracy, that reach a compromise during the 80s of the 20th century in the view to become national bourgeoisies in their countries, which in the case of Yugoslavia means in federal republics, which means the destruction of socialist federation, abandoning of socialism, and establishment of bourgeois nation states by the previous dominating groups, political bureaucracies and economic bureaucracies. Now, labor movements were disorganized in several ways. We won't speak about that because that's not our main topic today. The important thing is that this project of local dominating groups, political and economic bureaucracies, failed. It was not realistic. It was doomed to fail. Why? Because the historical conditions were not such as to allow the constitution of national capitalist states. The conditions were the crisis of the capitalist world system, the neoliberal response to this crisis, the new imperialist drive of the old center of capitalism, which means Euro-Atlantic center, world drive, the so-called globalization, neoliberal response to the crisis, intensive political military pressures, European Union, NATO pact, and economic pressures, International Monetary Fund, World Bank, World Trade Organization, most of those countries were highly indebted at the moment when they decided to establish national bourgeois capitalist states. So economic pressures that were led by the Euro-Atlantic fraction of the world capital. So this project of local ruling groups was doomed to fail in the majority of countries. It did not fail in Russia, for example, but it failed in other post-socialist countries, especially in Central Eastern European countries. So a supplementary solution imposed itself, partly by conscious maneuvering of local elites and partly by the logic of objective historical processes. The ruling groups rearticulated themselves into comprador bureaucracy. Comprador bureaucracy, that means political bureaucracy in the service of imperialist centers, and into dependent local capitalist class. So there are capitalist classes on the periphery and semi-periphery that perform super exploitation of the working masses, which means intensifying class conflict, plus do not participate to the formation of the world general profit rate. Capital productivity, to say in the terms in bourgeois economics, the profit rate is under the general average profit rate in the world. So they have to perform super exploitation on their own people. And illiberal democracy, as introduced by Viktor Orban explicitly as a doctrine, is a political regime attempting to create a new ruling bloc in this peripheral and semi-peripheral situation. A new ruling bloc, comprador bureaucracy, dependent local capitalist class, plus transnational capital, or selective linking to transnational world capital. Now, labor movements were disorganized in several ways by the state restoration of capitalist institutions from above. Market of the labor power was reintroduced to these regions. Introduction of non-standard labor relations, which we all know, the segmentation and discrimination of labor power on citizenship basis. This is the so-called migrant labor power, which means workers are discriminated against on the basis of citizenship. Immigrant workers do not have the rights that citizens of the hosting country enjoy. Agency work, platform work, destruction of social welfare, general privatizations, all those processes and practices combined to destroy the resistance of the labor. And of course, by political, juridical, and ideological fragmentation along ethnic and religion, the religious lines operated by governments and juridical and ideological apparatus. The beginning of this fragmentation of the labor class was the establishment of the new states. The new states on the territory of former Yugoslavia or on the territory of former Czechoslovakia or on the territory of former Soviet Union destroyed the whatever unity has existed before of the working class, and now it has not yet occurred that an international solidarity of workers has been established. And of course, by other bourgeois institutions like civil society, human rights, ideology and practices, state of law, liberal state of law, liberal ideological practices, etc. So in European Union, post-fascism is contained by liberal practices that perform its own its functions, the functions that otherwise post-fascism or open fascism would perform. Rearticulation of national bourgeoisies of Western Europe into a subordinated fraction of the world bourgeoisie, and disorganization of working people, which is basically the same as in the peripheral countries, fragmentation of social composition of labor power, which means introduction of different kinds of labor relations, reserve industrial army of unemployed. And it's a classical mechanism of dominating the labor, destroying labor rights by precarity plus introduction of civil contracts instead of labor law contracts. Very, very massive practice in all over Europe, destruction of social states and politics of recognition, which means identity politics, structuration of the social field into identity groups, which means fragmentation of potential resistance. Now, these are, I will show you two schemes that are simplifications, but show you, they show the difference between past situation when the classical historical fascism occurred, that is the situation of national capitalisms, of national economies, when the situation was determined by the classical separation of labor power from means of production and organization of production process. So this was under the domination of capital, and labor power had to sell itself to the capital. Now, in the result was general tendency towards homogenization of the basic unity of social reproduction, the household. National culture was the ideological cohesion mechanism, and within national capitalism, homogenized labor power had great strength labor struggles after national economies after World War II introduced and sustained welfare state both in the center, the capitalist welfare state, and in the periphery, socialist welfare state. Now, the present situation is different. That's contemporary capitalism, where you have different types of organization of the production process, and in supplement of the basic separation of labor power from means of production and organization of production process, there is a second separation of production processes from quasi-monopolies that dominate the global scene and organize the circulation of products. So the general tendency is towards heterogenization of household income, identity cultures, and social composition of labor power is heterogeneous. So this is a simplified scheme, which means production processes are separated from social conditions of production. And this is the place where local capitalisms of dependent capitalist countries situate themselves. They are separated from social conditions of production, which are controlled by transnational quasi-monopolies. So now we are coming to the second chapter of our presentation. And we speak about the paradox of the protest against semi-peripheral illiberal democracy in Slovenia. Now, the funny thing about, or the interesting thing about this protest is that it's explicitly claims that present government is fascist, which is anachronism, but that's how it is. Janšism is derived from the name of the prime minister, Janša, and here is the equation. Janšism is fascism. Together against fascism, neo-Nazism, and Janšism, with postscriptum, Janša, the prime minister, is a fascist. So we have an explicit equation of present regime with historical fascism. Death to Janšism, freedom to the people. This is a paraphrase of the national liberation slogan, Yugoslav national liberation slogan, death to fascism, freedom to the people. And an explicit linkage to socialist Yugoslavia. And what they demand, this radical anti-fascist movement, what they do they request? They want elections now. And this is the prognosis of the elections now. The leading government party would win them. It has a stable support, July, August, September. So prognosis of the composition of the parliament is that the leading governmental party is winning the elections and maybe could create a coalition. So this is the present composition of the parliament, the leading presumably fascist party on the top. These are coalition partners, and these are non-coalition partners that are supporting the coalition. So the composition of the parliament in the future, the prognosis is that the leading so-called fascist party will get even more seats than it has now. And the general effect of eventual effect of the 75 weekly protests, which means a year and a half of weekly protests that are radical in rhetorics, but very modest in their demands, elections now. This effect is strengthening of the leading government party, presumably fascist. Disappearance of coalition partners is something good, corrupted or sold out. Strengthening of the present opposition parties, which are all liberal with the exception of the left, Levica party. So the contradiction is that liberal opposition parties have conducted in the past and will conduct in the future the same neoliberal politics as the present government. And they justify that neoliberal politics with liberal rhetorics that feeds the populist support for the so-called fascist party. Liberal rhetoric is a gasoline for populist so-called populist reaction. It's elitist rhetoric. It's cynical rhetoric, and it's of course individualist struggle of all against the all. Rhetorics. It does not appeal to the large masses of people who then turn to the presumably fascist party, which will most likely win the next elections. So what is the political and ideological situation right now? In the parliament, the leading opposition is between liberal right and illiberal right. Maybe Levica is representing interests of the working people. Basically, they don't have much support in working classes. Now, the weak dominance of liberalism is discredited on the left and on the right. And if we look at the class composition of this ideological political situation, we see that petty bourgeoisie is present in all the fractions of the present political scene, which really reminds of the historical fascist situation. I skip this because we don't have time enough. Now here is the Poulantzas theory of fascism. He claims that fascism will come to power if the hegemonic capacity of the working class is in decline, which is the present situation, if the petty bourgeoisie is increasing, which is the present situation, and if the big capital is gaining in hegemonic capacity in the background, and at a certain point we see the fascists will seize power with the support of big capital and with ideological facade of petty bourgeoisie. So on very abstract terms, this is analogous to the present situation. But the objective historical situation is different. Look, here are opinion polls by Eurobarometer. What are the issues which made you vote in the recent European Parliament elections. In the center, it's climate and environment. That was the great propaganda at the moment. In the periphery, Eastern Central Europe and South, it's economy and growth. And the interesting exception, former Czechoslovakia, peripheral discontent, EU mechanisms, they want to change the domination of European bureaucracy. Now another, why did you not vote in the recent European Parliament elections? Depolitization, lack of trust, center and southern periphery, capitalist periphery, and depolitization in central periphery, ex-socialist periphery. Very interesting. Now, what are the reasons for your thinking that your country has benefited from being a member of the EU? A very difference between center of the center, Scandinavia, Denmark, Netherlands, Benelux, Belgium and Luxembourg, a peace security in the center, work opportunities, capital is coming to our countries, or our countries, or labor power is leaving our countries for the center, and the same basically Spain and Portugal. So GDP per inhabitant relative to EU average. This is incredibly interesting. That shows you the fragmentation of the center. Look at the Great Britain. GDP, like in periphery in certain regions of Great Britain, and the great periphery of Eastern Central Europe and the South. So what is the problem of European Union? The periphery is working more, but producing less. The blue is high GDP. Why is it producing less? For two reasons. Old technology, means of production, lower productivity of labor because of the means of production, and puncture of the surplus value that goes from periphery to the center. So center and periphery have each their own contradiction, fragmentation of both, crisis in the EU center, periphery of European center have two groups, south, traditional periphery of dependent capitalism, central Eastern Europe, post-socialist countries, newly annexed colonies of the EU. In each area, there are specific causes for neo-fascist, pro-fascist, and illiberal politics. And in this situation, the illiberal democracy was invented as the political regime that creates a new ruling bloc, as we have said. Comprador bureaucracy, dependent local capitalist class, and transnational capital. Viktor Orban formulated the doctrine of illiberal democracy as a new type of state. So what is the new type of state doing? It has to organize increasing exploitation, super exploitation on the periphery. It has to provide low paid and disorganized labor for the capital, both transnational and local. And this has to offer low corporate taxes, state subsidies to corporations, low ecological standards and state finance structure. So within this narrow maneuvering space, illiberal democracy proposes to carve out a niche for local ruling groups, comprador bureaucracy and dependent domestic capital. And this was explicitly stated by Viktor Orban in one of his speeches already in 2014. We have to invent a state that is most capable of making a nation successful. We have to look at Singapore, China, India, Turkey, Russia. It's a workfare state, not of a liberal nature. Illiberal state, not liberal, specific, national, particular approach. So the scheme is this: world competition of among nations, semi-periphery situation, a new form of state, workfare, increase of exploitation, and non-liberal democracy, which used to be called Totalstaat in German. So here are the introduction of the measures of the new forms of state intervention in Hungary and in Poland. The difference is that Hungary has a more brutal system of exploitation, and Poland has some support to families and social benefits. And the specificity of Hungary is sub-imperialism, economic and political expansion that makes Hungary a kind of sub-imperialist in the region. And it has to be said, they are relatively successful. They are economically expanding into Slovenia, Croatia, and partly into Serbia, which means they are rebuilding the old Hungarian empire, sub-empire, even expanding it into Slovenia. So, illiberal regimes are relatively successful if we look at public debt to GDP ratio. So, Turkey faring very low. This is the foreign the public debt. Of course, Greece is the top. Japan very high. United States, United Kingdom, of course. Slovenia rather high. Hungary lower. Poland very low. This is percentage of GDP. It's public debt to GDP ratio last year. If you look at the EU, we see that illiberal regimes are relatively successful if compared to United Kingdom or Italy or Portugal. However, illiberal regimes foment conflicts. They intensify social conflict and class struggle. These are trusting government last year, Poland very low, United Kingdom of course low, Hungary rather low, it's under 50%, Slovenia under 50%. Now, share of votes for populist and nationalist parties in European parliamentary elections in 2019, Hungary on the top, Italy on the top, Poland on the top, United Kingdom, of course, on the top. But we should add Slovenia, Slovene Democratic Party, which is not populist. Officially, it's a part of the European People's Party, should be placed here. It has 34-35% of support. It's stronger than populist vote in United Kingdom. Now, the point, which will be very short, is this. For its very contradictions, history is an open process. There is no predetermination where history will go. Social equality was an achievement of socialism. However, post-socialist countries manage social equality in a very unequal way. Look at this, a Gini coefficient, which is a measure of income inequality in OECD countries last year. Bulgaria, post-socialist country, one of the highest inequalities in OECD countries. Only Mexico, Chile, and Costa Rica are worse. Hungary, quite well. Poland, quite well. Slovenia, very well. And of course, post-socialist countries are on figure on both sides of this scale. Czech, Slovak Republic, Czech Republic, and Slovenia, and on the other side, Bulgaria. And look at this, EU. Post-socialism on the top, post-socialism at the bottom of inequality. These are the most equal, egalitarian countries. These are the most non-egalitarian countries. And the same is shown here. This is inequality in European Union. These are Slovakia, Slovakia, Slovenia, and Czech Republic. And on the top, again, post-socialist countries, Bulgaria, Lithuania, Latvia, and this is EU. They are beyond inequalities, beyond the average of inequalities in European Union. So the point is, anti-fascism is not enough. Fascist-like regimes are a solution to the crisis of capitalism. Fascist-like solutions attempt to respond to the crisis by strengthening the dominance of the local bourgeoisie and local capital, by compromising with transnational capital, and by increasing exploitation and misery of their own people. Fascist-like solutions respond to the crisis in the interests of the transnational capital and the local dominant classes. However, this is important, for its very contradictions, history is not predetermined. Progressive social forces endeavor to abolish the very conditions of the emergence of fascist-like crisis management. And to abolish the conditions means to eliminate the conditions of recurring crisis, which means to exit capitalism. This is the end of my presentation. I'm sorry I took 5 minutes, more than planned, but now the comments and discussion are welcome. Thank you for your patience and attention.